With 1200 horsepower at the wheels at around 35 PSI of boost pressure and the ability to rev to over 10,000 RPM, the integrated Motorsports R34 GTR is probably one of the most powerful RB powered time attack cars anywhere in the world. We're here with Peter from PMC Race Engines to find out exactly how that engine's put together and how it makes that sort of power. Now, Peter, those sort of power levels aren't unheard of, but normally we're probably hearing about those sort of power levels from a drag car that only needs to hold together for 6 to maybe 8 seconds at a time. You've got a car here that needs to perform for a lap that can last up to about a minute 30 around Eastern Creek here. It's a completely different kettle of fish, really. So can we start with the engine block? What have you got in this car?
Well, we use the billet, billet block. We've got the a custom 77.7 mil stroke crank. We use a aluminium forged rod from America and a billet piston to go with it. We run about 10.8 to 1 compression ratio. We run it very tight. We're trying to keep it as efficient as possible. And the bullet's so much better than any other way of doing it because it's 40 kilos lighter and it's so much stiffer. So we don't have any sealing issues. It seals the bore so much better. So they're getting...
Before we go too much further, because there's a lot of great stuff that you've just got into, so I want to just actually go back and unpackage some of that. So let's start. So you're using the bullet, billet aluminium engine block, a little bit of a mouthful there. And we've seen these come online over the last few years, and of course here at World Time Attack and Open and Pro Class, the billet alloy blocks have become the go-to, really, if you want to make that power reliably. So let's just go back over the advantages there. You've obviously said you're 40 kgs lighter. That's a world of difference for a start, but we're more interested in the strength aspect. So head gasket sealing is a real big issue with these turbocharged engines at high boost levels. Where are the advantages from that alloy billet block when it comes to sealing the head gasket, making sure that head is sealed tightly under high boost?
It's all to do with how thick the deck is. We're at a minimum 14 mil thick, and that gives massive rigidity. So the block doesn't move around under load, and of course it's got a very thick sleeve in it. So it's very stable with a big half-inch stud, and it's massive clamp load. So with a sealing ring like from Nitto, Nitto head gasket, we just don't have the head gasket issues anymore.
All right, so you just also mentioned there the bore. So with an alloy block, obviously we're not able to run the piston rings directly on that raw alloy finish. So these run a ductile iron sleeve that then gets pressed into the billet block. And those give you some advantages as well. The thickness of those sleeves is greater than the stock bore?
Absolutely. They're much stronger material. You can bore them out to 88 and a half. Capacity is always good. The structure of it is just not going to crack. And if there is an issue, it's easy just to pop it out, put a new one in, deck it, and back to work, you know.
I think that's something that's overlooked. Obviously, sometimes things happen in motorsport, particularly when you're pressing an engine this hard. And here, unlike with a stock block where you'd basically be forced to scrap an entire block if you have a problem in one cylinder, you can replace individual sleeves.
Yes, that has happened to us. We've had a lean out, absolutely torched it, and within hours, we've popped the sleeve out, put a new one in, decked it, bored it, honed it, back into service. I've actually built this one in 12 hours from scratch this week. So it can happen, but you cannot fix a steel block like that. So it would be thousands of dollars to fix another one, where this one was $1,000.
All right, so another aspect you mentioned there is the fact that you're running an aluminium conrod. Now, typically the alloy conrods is more something we would see in a drag racing application. They have some problems as well around their fatigue life, which doesn't really make them well suited to circuit racing. But of course, Time Attack is a fairly unique type of circuit racing. Give us your rundown on why you've gone to that alloy rod and what the advantages are as you see them.
Well, first of all, they're about half the weight. We use a Bill Miller rod from America, which is a forged rod, and they're so good on the bearing. We just don't hurt bearings. They're just such a cushion because of their aluminium construction. And because of that, we get much better bearing life, and we can really put the boost in without fear of hurting a rod. So they're much
better. I think particularly in drag racing terms as well, when these engines are being run right on the edge, if the engine is run briefly into detonation, then the alloy rod tends to absorb or cushion that impact from the detonation, which is what you're saying there. You don't end up hurting the bearing as a result. And the bearings on the big end of these engines are relatively small, given the power you're making.
Yeah, they're very small in an RB. We're undersized for what we really are. So even with a very high-end, you know, Carrillo rod, a slight bit of detonation, the bearing will fall out of it. It's just no way to hold its shape. With the Conrod, like the Bill Miller rod, we get away with that. So the tune, we're on the ragged edge. We're pushing the poor little 2.8 all the way. You know, massive revs, massive boost, and you know, it's more than 7 seconds. It's like, you know, a minute and a half, and sometimes we have to go around again. So the temperatures involved are much greater. So the aluminium rod's the only way we get away with that.
All right, now, in terms of this engine being 2.8 litres, obviously you've got the advantage with that billet block, but the rod-to-stroke ratio of the stock RB26 isn't great. Wouldn't typically be a rod-to-stroke ratio that would lend itself well to 10,000-odd RPM. Have you done anything there with the rod length to try and aid that rod-to-stroke ratio?
Not really. It's a little bit hard to do much with it because we're trying to keep the block as small as possible and as light as possible. When you go to the 30 block, it lifts everything up better. It's not so good for the weight distribution, but we also have harmonic issues with the longer rod, a longer block. So the 2.8 is about as much stroke as we would go, and there's not much we can do with that stroke ratio. It's not great, but we get away with it.
So essentially you're saying you've compromised the rod-to-stroke ratio and you haven't gone to a tall deck block.
Absolutely. But in the future, we are actually making a custom RB block, which is about 20 mil taller than the 26 block. And that's the biggest compromise that we'll make for height. And we don't want to lift that motor much more. It's all about making that thing go around the corner here. So that's the reason.
All right, now you also mentioned that you're running a billet piston, which again is not particularly common. So where do you see the advantages of a complete billet piston over an existing off-the-shelf or even custom-built forging?
It's just being able to actually make it strong enough to do what we're doing and also make it easy enough to actually be available, because we move them around a fair bit to get the shape that we want. And there's no off-the-shelf piston that can do what we want to do. It has to be strong enough to do what we're trying to do for lap after lap. So we custom make it for the compression ratio. We have holes in the ring to press rings out. There's all sorts of stuff we're doing.
Now, you're just talking about there are holes in the ring length, so just let's go into that. So you're using a horizontal gas port. Can you just tell us how those horizontal gas ports help?
Yeah, we're just trying to seal that ring up as much as possible with much load force on the ring to push it onto the bore. And we actually start creating a vacuum in the sump because we're not having the blow-by issues that we were once before.
So that leads me on to the rest of the bottom end, and another area where the RB26 is well known to have its share of issues is in the oiling department. Obviously, in this sort of application, you go straight for a top shelf dry sump lubrication system. Are there any other tricks or changes that are necessary around getting the RB bottom end reliable in terms of oil control?
With the billet, because it's so much stiffer, we're not having the bore flexing that we would normally see in a 26 block. So we negate the blow-by, which is most of the problem that we see with the oiling system. The oil just can't get back to the sump because it's got so much air going past those holes. So with the billet, it's not so bad because we can draw the oil out of the head via a stage in the pump, and we don't have those issues so much anymore.
So basically, when you can reduce that blow by, that actually gives you a significant improvement in the oil control capability.
Yes, and also a significant horsepower advantage. So we chase everything we can, especially at this level where Matt's trying to win this race. You know, we're doing 300 plus Ks down there at 10,000 revs. We need a very stable block.
All right, let's just move on to the cylinder head here, because obviously the bottom end really is just there to give us capacity and actually remain reliable, but it's really the cylinder head, coupled of course with the turbocharger, that is there to flow the air in and out of the engine and make the power. So what have you done there with the RB26 cylinder head?
Well, the 26 head is my sort of thing. I bought that that's my main job, you know. It's got beryllium seats in it, it's titanium valved, and well, in some of them, most of them we use a Freya super plus valve and valve spring package. It's a significant porting on the inlet side and a lot of shaping on the exhaust. Plus, we do a very open chamber design to get rid of squish, because they just cannot handle that squish.
Let's just talk about that. For those who aren't aware, particularly with the RB26 head, there are some significant squish pads, which in OE terms are generally there to help try and move the mixture formation in towards the spark plug. So where do you see the disadvantages of those squish pads, and why do you modify or remove them?
In a factory road car, you know, they only have 7 or 8 PSI, and they've got to meet emissions, and they're trying to make that, you know, event happened in a very tight place to get good emissions and decent power. But when you start pushing the things with 30 pounds of boost and, you know, 1,000 plus horsepower, that fuel control and the burn is critical, and we just can't get away with a closed chamber. We just can't get it. Detonation sets in and we lose motors all the time.
The cams in this, of course, as well, another key to the airflow. Can you give us some insight into what you're doing there, what the specs of those cams are?
Yeah, actually, they're getting smaller all the time. We're actually dropping them, and as you can see, you're going past 10,000 revs. You think, wow, that must have big cams, but, you know, they're very small. We're only going 265, 272, and they're revving to 10 because they've got such a big, you know, a modified inlet port. And we're running a very large single throttle body plenum. And all that air adds up to big revs. You don't need those camshafts. You don't want to waste that energy out the exhaust. You have to pull it off a corner and it's got to snap into action. So we don't go big on the cams anymore.
Now, in terms of the valve train as well, the RB26 cylinder head is already a direct bucket valve actuation, which is great for high RPM. Is there anything needs to be changed there with the bucket operation for reliability at 10,000 RPM?
Yeah, we have to DLC coat a bucket, and we remove the factory shim, and we make a longer valve, and then we tip it to length. So we move it away. It's a shimless valve setup, and it's the only way we can live at that, you know, 10,000 revs on downshifts and upshifts with a sequential gearbox.
So just moving away from the shim, which means that there's absolutely no chance of reliability problems with that shim making its way out. You've just got a one-piece bucket, but of course adds to the complexity of actually setting your valve lash.
Yeah, it certainly does. It's a fairly in-depth sort of process. And we work within micromillimeters to try to keep things exactly in time. Like two thou, too tight can change your, you know, degrees up to 12 degrees in timing. So we really keep that under control, and it's a very lengthy process. It's an expensive head.
Well, look, Peter, it's an amazing piece of engineering. It's an amazing feat as well, producing that sort of power for a time attack application. We've still got a couple of sessions to go today, and we know that you've had a few problems so far this weekend. Everything seems to be lining up for you, so we wish you all the best, and hopefully the car can put down a representative time in the next two sessions. Thanks for the chat there, Peter.
Thank you very much, and I really enjoy your show.
Thank you.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.